Thank you, Manoj. The only claim to be as chief guest today is the position that I held about 2 years back as Secretary of Water Resources and Ganga Rejuvenation. Otherwise, a large number of persons sitting in this room, they know 100 times more than me on this particular subject. And whatever today I know, I owe to them. Some dots kept getting connected, and today is the day that I thought I must acknowledge the knowledge that I gained through them. Ravi Chopra ji, Professor Braj Gopal, Professor Gosai, both Himanshus, Professor Tare, Malika, Bhavna bhi aayi hai. I'll tell you a small story how we made presentation before the Supreme Court judge, where Bhavna contributed a lot. So a number of them, Professor Dinesh Mishra ji. So little bit what I understood through them and little bit what I read, I thought that this is the time that we should talk about. We always, whenever we talk about Ganga, we first see it from the religious point of view, cultural point of view, faith point of view. But why Ganga is the most revered river? Why is it so? Why our forefathers constructed large number of temples across the river and also on the basins? Were they only culturally attached, or were they only religiously attached to this river, or there was something more to it? I find that whatever little knowledge that I have, our forefathers, anything that they did, it had overtones on the health, economy, and overall sustainability. Whether they constructed a large number of tanks in Tamil Nadu, where they declared sacred groves in different places. Sacred groves are actually the place where groundwater, the aquifers get recharged. If you destroy that, aquifers will not get recharged. So everything that they did, why do we celebrate Diwali only in October? It's because after monsoon, large number of insects spring up. And by burning diyas, they get attracted to that and get killed. So after Diwali, you don't have much insects and mosquitoes in the house. So everything, I find that anything and everything that our forefathers did had sustainability overtones. So what was the sustainability overtones in Ganga? Its unique properties, Ravi Chopra ji had very clearly mentioned, it had unique properties. What I read in some books, that Ganga water had 25 times more oxygen carrying capacity than any other river in the world. 25 times more. And that was the reason why it would not putrefy. Meri maa kehti thi ki Ganga jal rakh lo, ye kabhi gand kharab nahi hoga. I would never appreciate that time, but today, with little bit of knowledge that one has gained, it doesn't putrefy at that time. And still, in the reaches on the upper Himalayas, if you pick up those water, it doesn't putrefy. But apart from that, it had also certain medicinal properties. That's why people used to take when they had choleras. Aur kehte hain ki aap usme naha lo to aapki paap dhul jayegi. Paap nahi hai, you know, basically you get cleansed up. Some historical information that I gathered, my minister, Madam Bharti, once he told me that when, I don't know where did she read, but she's a very well-read person, that Alexander, when he was coming to India, his Guruji asked him that, you know, when you come back, please bring water from that particular river, which is supposed to be very unique in its quality. Second, she used to tell us that Akbar used to regularly drink Ganga water. Third, which is a recent phenomenon, all of you would have gone to Jaipur and the palace, city palace, where there is a huge silver vessel. I believe the story goes that whenever the Maharaja would travel to England in the ship, he used to take Ganga water because that would not putrefy. You know, it used to take more than a month to reach England. So the uniqueness of the river property is known, and there are enough documents, scientific evidence, and perhaps that's why our forefathers linked it to religion, so that we don't destroy it. But what has happened over the last perhaps 200 years, we diverted ourselves, we deviated from the traditional thinking, which was more towards sustainability, and moved to more towards immediate economic gains. It's like killing the goose which lays golden egg. Immediate economic gains, not long-term sustainable economic gains. And perhaps that is the reason why we kept doing those 1,000 structures, and another 500 are being threatened to be set up, constructed on in the Ganga Basin, is as a result of that. What economic gains have we got? This has to be perhaps more detailed and economically analyzed. When we construct a dam or a reservoir, we do two things. Basically, one to generate power, and second is to irrigate areas. Let us talk about the irrigation part. When you irrigate, by constructing a dam, you irrigate X, the command area may be, say, let us say 50,000 hectares. But when a river flows, it recharges the aquifers. Each aquifer may have its own command area. Sum total of all the command area of each aquifer, all the aquifers, may be many times more than the command area of a reservoir. So is the, I mean, does the economy support such big constructions, or we should think of no construction, allow the river to flow? These are the research which I think are to be gone in, so that the policy makers are able to think not different. Coming back again to Ganga, where have we gone wrong? Ganga today is one of the most endangered riverine ecosystem. One of the most endangered riverine ecosystem. Have we ever seen Ganga as a riverine ecosystem in our modern days of, in the modern days when we talk about the development? A riverine ecosystem, to the limited knowledge is that I have, is right from the mountains with the thick natural forest as catchment area, the floodplains when it descends on the ground, on the plains, then the wetlands, the biotas, then the marshlands, then the creeks, mangrove, all put together make a riverine ecosystem. Riverine ecosystem, water is both part and product of the riverine ecosystem. When I say part, if you remove water from the system, ecosystem, will the ecosystem survive? No. So it is a part of the ecosystem. Product, yes. We say when the water flows. When you start diverting the product, and when you start diverting 100% of the product, you are killing the part. So when the part gets killed, the system, obviously, what Mano said, that is bleeding to death. Systematically, whether it is the upper catchment area, the forests have been destroyed. We, despite Bhagirathi eco-sensitive zone having been declared as eco-sensitive zone, The government of Uttarakhand every day knocks at the door of the government of India to allow them to construct power plants. Every day. In fact, the chief minister, one of the chief ministers, said that aap kya Uttarakhand ke dushman hai, jo allow nahi karte ho. What are we going to get out of those few hydropower plants? And will you be able to sell that power? My understanding, having worked in the power sector for long and having worked in the water sector, knowing the hydrology, knowing how much of power that it can generate, pure economics would give you power at nothing less than 8 rupees per unit. Who will buy 8 rupees power today? Solar is available at 244. Will you buy? I will not. Definitely I would not like to buy. So why are they pushing for hydro projects? Answer obviously lies somewhere else, and all of us understand where does the answer lie, why they are pushing for it. It's a nexus. Last time also we talked about contractors, politicians, bureaucrats, nexus. It is a nexus, pure nexus. Why are we digging up the sand, the quarries on the river bed, knowing very well that it's the floodplain, the sand, thick sand bed, actually holds water and allows the groundwater to get recharged. If we destroy that sand bed, ultimately we are ensuring that the posterity will not have adequate quantity of water. And that is what is becoming visible. Water availability is shrinking. Not only per capita, but even area-wise. Every day you will find problem in Maharashtra, every day you, even in Uttar Pradesh, which has large number of rivers, rivulets, drains. 2016, when the country was reeling under drought, and the Honorable Prime Minister, who met 9 chief ministers individually, Uttar Pradesh chief minister said that the groundwater table has sunk to 80 meters. I mean, this can't be, you can't imagine 80 meters groundwater table in Uttar Pradesh, where a large number of rivers flow, big rivers, B, it is all river alluvium soil, which holds water, and over 1200 millimeter of rainfall. So water table going down to that level is difficult to imagine. Bihar, I remember, you know, I come from Bihar, it's 10 feet water. Places, it used to be 10, 50, 15 feet water. We never had any problem of water in Bihar. Today, Bihar also has 60, 70 meter groundwater table has gone down. If groundwater table goes down, the base flow, obviously, as pointed out in the presentation, obviously will base flow in the river will suffer, will be compromised. And today, the base flow in Ganga or practically any river in the country hardly exist. If you see from Kanpur till almost Allahabad, you see only sand track. You don't see water or some trickling here and there, but you don't see. People cross the river. I lived in Patna for ages. We used to have round the year steamer service across the river. Only in 82, when the bridge was constructed, that people stopped that steamer service, which means Ganga had water round the year. Today it does not have. If Ganga has to be rejuvenated, we must, 40% of the country's landmass this basin occupies, 50% of population, people are dependent on this river, and the water availability. Then we have to obviously handle it as a basin, and more importantly, understand the river in its natural ecological form as a riverine ecosystem. Unless we address the entire riverine ecosystem, Ganga River riverine ecosystem, For reverse rejuvenation, Ganga rejuvenation will be difficult. At least some semblance of its pristinity will start coming back only when we handle the Ganga river and ecosystem. To do that, right from the upper catchment area, right from all the tributaries, sub-tributaries, their catchment, the floodplains, the groundwater, the natural vegetation which provided uniqueness to this river, the sediments pass through those Bhagirathi eco-sensitive zone, which is rich in medicinal plants. Perhaps the river acquires those unique properties by flowing through that eco-sensitive zone. Then the wetlands, only then the river will have round the year water. And it will survive and sustain itself. Where we have gone wrong is visible. Our action, unfortunately, has also been not up to the mark, or leaves far, far to be desired. We started way back in 79. But why did we confine ourselves only to pollution? Was it ever debated among the experts that if the Ganga River has to be revived, rejuvenated, then how we should go about, what action plan we should develop and act on? Perhaps not. A typical bureaucratic approach, ganda hai to sewage ko attack karo. And since 79 till 2018, we are only attacking sewage. Industrial pollution bhi bahut jyada nahi kar rahe hain. What about flow? Even if you take pollution, the best way to handle pollution is to, the solution to pollution is dilution. So dilution to pehle kar lo. So for dilution, you have to release water. For releasing water, the order that we see in 2018 about e-flow, unfortunately, woefully inadequate. But at least one positive aspect is that government has at least now started realizing that e-flow is an important issue. I'm not a pessimist. I think that, let us be optimist, hopefully with more studies and more good intention, the quantum will keep increasing. We also have to see whether those constructions, those major minor dams, have they lived their life? Have they performed their economic duties? If they have, then can we come out of it? Two things at the end. You know, normally people say that when we retire, we become more, we acquire more wisdom. When you are in the government, you don't do your work. To a large extent, true. I can advise today, I can say that why government is not doing that, I'm not accountable. But when I was there, what did I do? Was it adequate or not, is a question that people may ask. I don't claim much, but two things that we tried, to a certain extent we succeeded. One, tried to drill in the minds of the government that environment flow is essential, you have to do it. Otherwise, don't talk about rejuvenation. What you're talking about is cleaning part, not rejuvenation part. Second part is treat the river in its entirety, that is the basin, and Professor Tare and his team who developed, that's the first time that a basin level thinking emerged in the government. Though action plan is still is far more divorced from the thinking, but at least there is a document. Third thing is to bring about a legislation. We couldn't succeed having a separate legislation, though it's a national river, we could have. But what we could maximum achieve was the legislation, which is a subordinate legislation. In 2016, and it is under Environment Protection Act. Obviously, the act itself is a very weak act. It is a rig. is a regulatory act. It regulates the quantum of pollution that you can permit. It is not a action-oriented act. It's not a legislation where, no, you have to do this. What you cannot do is mentioned. It is not what you cannot do, what you should do. And last point, we thought that in this country, if Supreme Court comes with a hammer, then we act. Because, you know, you draw some strength. Sometimes it's difficult to penetrate the political system. So bring some order from the Supreme Court. Believe it or not, we tried that also. Bhavna would bear me out. We prepared, we met the then Chief Justice and said that it is not only my duty, or it's not only the duty of the executives. It is, you are equally responsible and you have also a role to play as a judicial system. You have a role to play. Without that, I can't. I need a order on the platter to do work. Some states don't cooperate. Some officials convince the political master that they should be asked to. Everybody saw 20,000 crores of rupees. We were asked to prepare a comprehensive presentation. We prepared, and believe it, 3 hours we gave presentation to the then designate Chief Justice. Three times we made presentation. Couple of times we met. I thought that if some order comes, the Chief Justice who became Chief Justice when he was a Supreme Court judge said that, kya Ganga, log, kya Sarkar kumkaran ho gayi hai, koi action nahi le rahi hai. We thought that he has some emotional attachment, so let us try to invoke his emotion into Ganga. Success level was that I could make presentation. Beyond that, I could not invoke his emotional attachment to the system, river. Little bit here and there, efforts were there, but it's inadequate, woefully inadequate. So I am hopeful that the deliberation of next 3 days will give a new dimension in the thinking, and hopefully when we present to the government, that may get reflected in the action plan. One thing which I now realize that we have to have a very strong legislation. If you treat this river as the natural river, a river which is revered, people have faith in that, then you have to treat this river differently. One justice in Uttarakhand, I admire his courage that he treated this as a living entity, a legal entity. A legal entity will have certain rights and duties. So can we have a rights-based legislation so that there is a definitive roadmap through the legislation, and we achieve that result that all of us here are desiring to. Thank you very much.